a lot of people think that football was the sport that took me the furthest. And though I do have the rings and yes, I have the uniform, oddly enough, the sport that that took me the furthest was actually cheerleading. The funny thing about it is I actually, technically speaking, played golf years before I'd ever played football. Prominent mental coach for the PGA Tour named Brett McCabe, and he was talking about how the best of us don't focus on being the best every day, but we focus on being the best with what we have on a daily basis.
There is a podcast brewing that's about to take over podcasting for good. The only podcast that you are going to need to tune into day in, day out, is the Member Guest Podcast.
If I can hit it down the middle of the fairway, that's great. But again, with the driver right now, the driver sucks.
And now, the Member Guest Podcast!
John Daly. You're listening to the Member Guest Podcast. Rippin', rippin'.
All right, CJ, aka Mr. Is it just Tyga Hoods? And everybody
yes, sir,
knows you on Instagram.
A lot of people have seen this logo. Hold on, let me grab my first bag. A lot of people have seen that logo and
yeah, dude,
that
one of the,
bag
one of the
just
coolest
because of
bags. One of the coolest bags I've seen. How'd you get that? Did you custom do that, or do you have something with PXG?
So I custom did that. I reached out to one of my friends. So back in the day, I used to work at Apple. And so I have a lot of very cool, very creative friends. And one of my boys is the owner of a graphic design firm. And so I reached out and I said, hey, Jeremy, I would love to get a logo. And this is the name. This is what I want. And he goes, say less. And about 72 hours later, that logo comes back. And yeah, it's kind of been full throttle since then. And then I was able to find a great embroiderer who happens to be the staff embroiderer, not the staff, but the contracted embroiderer for PXG. And she's done a lot of work on a lot of really, really cool bags. DJ Khaled is one of the bags that she did. She did like all of the 49ers. She did Zach Johnson's stuff for the Ryder Cup. So when I went in there, you know, I found this big old Ryder Cup patch that she just randomly had sitting on a table. And she shows me all the fonts, and I go, do you have the DJ Khaled one? She goes, yes. And I go, cool, I will take that.
Do that.
And then I add a few more fun little elements. Like, I have, like, reflective elements on there, kind of like the pair of Yeezys that came out a few years ago that are all reflective. So, yeah, just wanted to make it a little fun, a little bit different, and, you know, a little bit less quiet than golf is used to being.
Yeah, for sure. It's kind of the trend that we're seeing things go towards a little bit, which we'll love to talk about. But first of all, I want to talk a little bit about your background, because a lot of our listeners, or like the reason we started the podcast, was for, you know, people really just like getting into golf for, like, you know, over the last couple of years, everybody is spending a lot more time on it. You have a lot of these, you know, call right. it ex-athletes or people that maybe played at a high level like you did, played football, like catching that golf right. bug because of the competitiveness. And so, you know, this call it episode is a little bit more geared towards, like, you know, you, your background as an athlete than how you started to get into to golf, and like how it's just so different of yeah. a sport to learn and become elite at. And so I've been following your journey for a little bit, which is super fun. You're down in Arizona, so next time I'm there, we're gonna maybe just real quick, talk about your background, and then
let me know.
You know, yeah, Greyhawks right up the street, right?
Let's say, yeah, Greyhawks literally right up the street. So I love seeing the flags right there. And you said that TPC Scottsdale, you have a flag of that. So that's literally outside my window right here behind me. So, you know, if you're ever down here, let me know. Golf on me.
Yeah, absolutely. I usually save it for those winter months, which we were talking about, gets a lot more expensive. But we'll figure out a time. I might have to be down there soon for work. So. Let's talk about your time at, I guess
beautiful.
Just the background, and then football played at ASU, and then how it's kind of all led to where you're at now.
Yeah, so it's funny because a lot of people think that football was the sport that took me the furthest. And though I do have the rings and yes, I have the uniform, oddly enough, the sport that took me the furthest was actually cheerleading. So when I was a true freshman out of high school, I actually went to Purdue for a semester, and I was a cheerleader there. And then after I tore my ACL playing football, I actually ended up as a cheerleader at ASU. So it's one of those things where it was kind of random how I fell into that sport. But in the end, I got hurt playing football in high school, and I decided the football was over for me. And so I wanted to go and play something else. And I decided to go where the girls were, right? And, you know, that took me through a 10-year journey. But then in that, being, so I'm 6'5" and like 300 pounds. And so in that, everybody would just go, "So you played football?" And I go, "No, I am a cheerleader." And they go, "Okay, cool. So you played football?" And I go, No, I'm not. I'm a cheerleader." And they go, "Okay, cool. So you play football?" And after a while, I just go, "Cool. Now I play football." And, you know, I had played a bunch of other sports in my life. I was raised in the Netherlands, and so soccer is actually my first sport. And so I played that until, you know, I was 16, 17 years old, went through the club system and all of these things. And so I didn't want to play football. And, you know, again, no disrespect to people that go, that went to D2s, junior colleges, D3s, all of those things. But I wanted to play at the highest level that I possibly could. And I knew that if I worked hard enough, I would end up playing in a D1 school. And so I ended up walking on at ASU at the age of almost 21 years old. And they had never seen me play football. And I hadn't played football since I was, I don't know, 16 years old, maybe 17 years old. And so it was one of those things where I just, you know, through sheer will and boneheadedness, I ended up earning myself a spot on that team, played there, tore my ACL. And the next thing you know, I was back in my whole cheerleading world and getting to hang out with, you know, a bunch of wonderful people and travel around. And so that's kind of the sports journey. And the funny thing about it is I actually, technically speaking, played golf years before I'd ever played football. And just had said, you know what, this isn't the sport for me. This is something that I can do better things with my time. And I was 12 years old at this point in time. So, you know, don't blame me. But then I decided to come back one day and now we're here.
Yeah. So you moved, I mean, I imagine living in Arizona probably has a little something to do with that. And as I've seen your content on Instagram and stuff that you do, I wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, one of the topics we talk about here a lot is just like the mental game of golf. And I saw one of your posts about just the mental side, like working with a coach about the mental side and practicing like quality over quantity, right? Cause like I was a ball hitter myself for the longest time. I've got a simulator in my garage.
Same.
I just pound balls, right? Do you like, I pound a couple hundred balls a day.
Right.
And then you start to realize like with golf, how it's a lot more, you know, technical. It has a lot more to do with, you know, like the way that you train the muscles to move. And so as you've gotten in, like as a 6'5", 300 pound dude, like how do you make your body work in a golf swing and kind of, you know, what are the things that you've done over the past couple of years to actually get a, you know, a nice looking swing and be able to go out and play golf at a high level?
So very much like you, I was a ball hitter. So kind of to go back to the beginning of this whole journey, speaking of being a ball hitter, so this all started in 2022 when my girlfriend and I went to Topgolf and she saw just the sheer amount of balls that I hit. And she goes, "You should do this more often." And kind of one thing led to another. And I ended up spending a huge amount of time hitting balls at Topgolf. And then in 2023, I figured that, very similar to you, that hitting a bajillion balls a day is not going to actually help. And so what ended up happening is I ended up falling upon a simulator facility called Zion Golf Club, which is right here in Scottsdale. Wonderful place. And I ended up putting 340 something hours in on a Trackman between January or between April and December of 2023. And in that, I was just kind of feeling things out. So, you know, you see all the numbers on the Trackman, all of these things. I took some time to understand what those numbers were, and then I just started trying things. I wanted to see if I could change where my hand placement was. I wanted to see if I could change how much my knees were bent. I wanted to change all of these different things. And so for me, it was a huge amount of trial and error at the beginning. For the first, you know, year and a half of this whole thing, it's been a huge amount of trial and error. And then after doing all of that, I decided, okay, cool, I'm going to go and see a coach. And I'm very, very lucky being here in Arizona that we have a wealth of wonderful coaches. And I ended up landing upon a gentleman named Colin McCarthy, who's a really, really great guy. And he was able to help break a couple things down that I just didn't understand because I'm not a golfer. And he was able to say, okay, cool. Because you're a little bit of a bigger guy, you need to do this. Because you're a little bit of a bigger guy, you know, you need bigger grips. That was one of the big things, right? Is understanding the actual equipment that I needed. He sits there, he looks at my shafts and he goes, those are going to be a little bit whippy for you. They're stiff shafts. And he goes, you probably going to need extra stiff, right? And all of these things over the last year and a half have kind of come together. And now I can actually hit the ball straight, which is cool. But it's just taken a lot of perseverance and boneheadedness and just the willingness to try and fail and be bad at something, which was probably the hardest part for me. And, you know, because being bad at golf in public has been an issue for me mentally. And so I really wanted to put the time in, put the energy in to not be quite as of an issue on the golf course. And we're getting there.
Yeah, dude, it's funny that you mentioned that because, like, I would say people that either golf frequently or are good at golf completely understand those days when you just don't have it. You know what I mean? Like, even right. Scratch golfers can go out there and fire a 85 or a 90. Like, it looks like they've never swung a golf
right.
before. And then, you know, the same golfer can right. go out the next day and shoot even par. And I always talk about, like, right. with my buddies, you know, can I ask, like, what is your handicap? What's your index at? Do you keep one?
Like a 17, 18.
Yeah. So you're like right around a bogey golfer, right? Like, and when you tell people that, you know, they'll be like, hey, you should be shooting bogey every single time that you go play. When in reality, like, your index represents your best, I think it's 6 rounds out of 20, right? Which is 30% of the time that you play. Where that other 70%, like, doesn't even right. get factored into your index. And so it's all to say that, like, a lot of bad golf right. gets played just to play like 30% of your rounds being good golf. And it takes people a little bit of like time to right. kind of comprehend that.
Right. Right. And it's hard for people. It's really, really hard for people to realize when they don't understand what that actual number means. Right. Because to your point, most people don't know that the handicap really is representative of a very small percentage on a rolling basis of the rounds that you play. So, you know, a lot of times people get very, very caught up in that and all of those things. And it's just like, well, realize that sometimes it's not going to be that. And, you know, I recently was listening to a reel from a very, very prominent mental coach for the PGA Tour named Brett McCabe, and he was talking about how the best of us don't focus on being the best every day, but we focus on being the best with what we have on a daily basis, right? So, you know, for a regular golfer like myself, that means that, okay, cool, so I can hit my 7-iron X amount of yards, but if I'm, you know, maybe I'm a little bit sore that day, I can't sit there and get mad at myself because I'm not hitting my 7-iron that far. Maybe it's a rainy day. Maybe it's, you know, there's all of these different things. And really now for me, it's just about maximizing what it is that I have based on what I have that day, not, oh, I need to go out and shoot an 85 every single time.
Yeah, there's a, I follow a guy, I wish I knew his name so I could give him a shout out. But he's like a plus five or plus six handicap. And he gives like tips as to how to become not only a scratch golfer, but like a better scratch golfer. And he said one of the biggest things
right.
that he realized was like, and this has to do with pros too. The pros find ways to play well, even on their off days. Like for them, obviously they're at a way different level, but you know, you're talking about like maybe those days that you're not hitting as many fairways, right? You're not hitting as many greens. Like you got to really find a way to dial in your chipping and putting that day, right? Or like you got to find a way to kind of adjust right. after hole four or five when you just might not have your best, to your point. And I thought that was like, huh, you know, when I go back and I think about, you know, a Scottie Scheffler, obviously number one in the world right now, and he is absolutely on a tear, right? You look at his four rounds normally, you know, two of them he'll go really deep, right? He'll go like six, seven under. But the days that he's not playing well, he doesn't shoot four or five over. He finds a way to grind out and shoot like even par or I think his actually consecutive streak just broke. Like he'll shoot even par one under, right? And those other guys might shoot three, four over right. and then they're out of the tournament. And so it's, you know, as amateurs, it can be
right.
difficult to, like, get yourself into that mindset when you have this expectation every time that, like, I know I'm capable of this, but I need to find a way to kind of figure it out.
And for Scottie Scheffler especially, and he said something that was very, very enlightening. I think it was yesterday when, like, a little kid was at the press conference. His name's Titus. And he asked him a question.
Yeah, Titus. Hell yeah.
Yeah, it was the little kid named Titus who was like, hey, so how did you keep yourself cool when, you know, you were going to make it whatever it was, a triple bogey on four or whatever it was, right? And Scotty says one of the most insightful things, and he goes, honestly, I had to sit there and realize that I wasn't actually I wasn't playing bad golf. I was just getting unlucky. Like I just got unlucky. I hit a great shot and it hit a tree and then it went out of bounds. Like that's like, I can't sit there and beat myself up about that. And you know, that's, I think, just one of those things that keeps him very, very just mentally other from the rest of us, because of the fact that for us, we hit a tree and it goes out of bounds, we freak out. Right. But for him, he just goes, that was a good shot. Got a little bit of a bad break. And I think that that's a really important thing that just makes him one of those other golfers that, because not that many people can just so easily move on from things like that.
Yeah, dude, their mental toughness has to just be on a completely other level. And then to just like, again, talking about like getting better, there's so many different aspects of the game. But, you know, right now, let's say you're 17, 18. I don't know what your goal is to get to. What are some of the things that you've been working on lately? Because obviously I follow all your stuff. Like I watch what's going on. See, you got the chipping and putting green in the backyard, which is nails, by the way. What's the stuff right now that either one, you're working on, or two, what's actually paying off to get the game to be a little bit easier for you? Just because we talk about all the time on our show, you know, helping people get better at golf, helping people like, you know, maybe they're in that little lull, middle of the summer, like early in the season. Like, you know, what's sometimes all you need is that one little swing thought or swing change that resonates with you or like
right.
one person, and then it clicks. You go and try it, and like you're back,
right?
Like, what are you working on right now, and
right.
what's getting you back?
So the big things that I'm working on right now, because one of the big changes that I made as of late was getting Jumbo Max grips, and so. One of the big things that I've been changing is how I interact with the actual golf club, if that makes sense. Because for the longest time, and actually I can pull out one of these bad boys. So for the longest time, I was out here, I mean, death gripping, and you can actually like see how tight everything gets in there.
You got big hands.
I was
and
death
like
gripping
you played football. Yeah.
Every single
muscles. Yeah.
Yeah. Like this, like, I shouldn't be able to go 100% around a regular grip like that, but I was, and I was going 100% around, and I was, I mean, you can't see it anymore because thank goodness I got new grips, but I was tearing up my hands, and it was leading to my swing being very just tight and bunched up because it started from my hands and it went all the way up and then it went all the way down. So in the change that I've made, one of the big things is being able to not have as much grip pressure per se and not death grip, but then that also allows me to change my tempo. And so right now, the big thing that I'm working on is trying to keep my tempo consistent and trying to not overswing. And that's very, very easy for a big guy like me because I want to see the ball go far. I know that I can make the ball go far, right? Like, you know, there are days when, you know, I can very, very easily carry by 7-iron 185 yards, right? And I would love to be able to swing faster, swing harder, and make that happen. But I have to keep in my mind, well, let's slow down, because if you swing harder, we're going nowhere. We're going left. We're going right. We're going back to what you did a year and a half ago, right? So that's really the big thing that I've been working on as of late. That being said, the other things that I'm focusing on right now, which, you know, I just haven't had quite as much time to work on as I would like to, but frankly, and this is going to sound very coachy of me, but it's chipping and putting. That is 100% where I am trying to improve and what's making the game easier for me, especially on the chipping side, because I was a very, very bad chipper when it came to anything that wasn't a very even lie. And so I've been very much trying to put myself in scenarios where, you know, I might be in a little bit deeper rough. I might be on the side of a hill. I might be in all of these places. And that's really made the game a lot easier because of the fact that I'm not sitting there and taking two strokes to get something out of the rough where I could have very, very easily taken one much better stroke and got it, you know, much closer to the hole. So those are kind of the things that I'm working on, what's made golf easier. Actually, and then the one other thing that makes golf a lot easier is just making those equipment changes and understanding the right equipment for me and my size of body. And so, again, a little bit of a plug for Colin, but my coach, Colin McCarthy, really talks about this thing called the golf body type. And he was able to, in essence, screen me through all of the things that he does and tell me that, you know, hey, you need to make some very, very specific changes to your setup to be able to swing in the most effective way, you know, get the most distance, all of these things. And in making those changes, I've already seen a really big
difference. Yeah, that's awesome, dude. I took two things from that. One, grip pressure, not only on your normal clubs, driver, irons, everything, but one of our really good players at my club, he's won our club championship before, his name's Jack Hill, and he gave me one of the best tips earlier this season. He's like, dude, on your putting, you need to loosen up your grip. Because it helps so much with speed control. When you have a really tight grip on your putter, you kind of like lose that feel and you start to guide it a little bit too much. And he's like, just loosen up your grip pressure a little bit. And I swear to God, man, the last like 3-4 holes,
yeah,
my speed control and everything was just that much better. And then the second one was, I know like you talked a little about your body type, but I recently, and I am going to have this guy on the pod, mental golf coach. You know, there's the aspect of talking about the mental game and like how to approach a course, how to approach like your shots. But this dude ran me through like almost a personality assessment or personality quiz. Have you ever taken one of those? Like, that, you know, it tells you like you're an ESFJ or like INOP or whatever. Yeah. So like you can take those for free. And so he sent me a link to take this. And he was like, you know, based on your personality type, like you actually don't, like you're not a visual learner, right? Like you're a technical learner, right? Or, you know, you're this type of person. So this might be easier for you to apply when you get on the course. And I started to do some of the changes over the last few weeks. And it's really interesting how different brains work differently, right? Especially with golf, the way that you see a shot or see the course or whatever. I'd be really interested. I should link you up with this test to see what you come out as and see if you can maybe take some positives from that, because it's pretty sweet.
Hit me. I would love that. That would be great. And I mean, anything at this point in time, one of the big things, one of my big goals for this year is doing anything that I can to just get better and to find those little things that can change my game. And so if that's what that sounds like, one of those like very, very little things that can change a huge amount. So I would love to see it.
Yeah. It's like the biggest thing for me right now that, you know, I try not to focus on too much every single time I go out, because otherwise you have 10 different swing thoughts and all these feels and everything. So I'm trying to just stick to like one or two. But the biggest one that I took from the mental process was like, one is always picking the target that I'm hitting to, but then actually visualizing the shot. He said I'm not a visual learner, like when I actually look at a putt, but if I can see it in my head, like create the own visual for myself, because I'm not good at seeing it actually happen, that has seemed to work out really well for me. Like, I think it's why a couple of years ago, Sergio Garcia used to close his eyes when he putt the ball. I don't know if you remember this, but he would literally close his eyes when he would putt. And it was just all feel. He said he was like seeing it in his brain, right? And then like the body had just done it so many times that he got used to it. So it's little stuff like that that, you know, if it saves you a stroke, like, sweet, we're getting our scoring average down.
Well, and it's funny that's the way that you kind of learn things, because so my golf journey in general started with Tiger Woods Golf 2003 on the PlayStation 2. That is how I got into golf. My mother saw me play, like, I vividly remember it was like Christmas in 2000, or actually, yeah, I guess it was Christmas in 2001. And I brought my PlayStation with me to California to my grandparents' house with one game and one game only. And it was Tiger Woods 2002. And I was hammering away at this game. I mean, hours a day. And my mother goes, do you want to go and play actual like golf? And I go, I'll give it a try. This game seems fun. I'll give it a try. But all of that to say, because since playing that game so much, which I still play that specific version still, especially when putting, that's how I have to visualize my putts. I have to visualize my putts like I'm in a video game, and I have to visualize my shots like I'm in a video game, because that's the actual context that I have for golf from when I'm younger. And so I sit there, and maybe I don't close my eyes, but I have to sit there and I look out at a fairway, and it's like in the video game where that little point shows up, and it's like that little point of light, and it kind of moving around based on where. That's how I have to set up my shots, because I sit there and I just go, point, I want it, no, there, yes, I want it there. And then I have to work everything backwards from there, kind of like I'm in a video game, which is the weirdest thing, but it seems to work out pretty okay.
Dude, there's a lot of different ways to do it. Like, my co-host, he can't make it during the middle of the workday here today over my lunch break, but he said there's so many different ways that like different golfers approach like how to make it work. Right. Like, you just kind of at the end of the day have to find out what works for you. And the really sucky part about that is for us as amateurs, like, we don't have a lot of the resources that pros have, or like maybe we don't have the time to do all these things. And so, like, real quick, I just kind of want to talk about, you know, whether it's practicing in your backyard or like the time that you have before a round. What is the time that you practice, or do you set aside specific days of the week or times to actually go and practice? Are you kind of like me where, you know, if you've got a 3 o'clock in the afternoon tee time, that like hour that you have before is kind of your practice? Like, how do you break it up?
I'm a huge practice person, and that it's a little bit of a problem just because of the fact that I am a perfectionist in a way, in that I like going on the course, but I don't like going on the course sometimes because of the fact that I'm not doing things perfectly, right? So for me, last year, I was very, very lucky that my full-time job, if you will, was being a golf creator, right? That is all that I did last year because I didn't have an actual 9-to-5 job. And so I would set out 3 hours a day every single day. And I would go and I would get on the Trackman and I would typically spend my first hour to hour and a half working on my swing, and then the back half of that time going out and playing virtual courses, right? So I do like to set out time to actually practice, but the other big thing for me is that, you know, and I know that a lot of people say this, but, you know, I'm 100%, I believe this too, is that golf is something that I use as kind of therapy for my mental health, right? Because I was diagnosed as bipolar a couple years ago, 4 years ago now. And I've come to find that when I am in athletic motion one way or another, at some point in time in a day, I just have better days, right? And so I have always liked to be very, very intentional in making sure that I put that time away for myself every single day. And, and it's been great. And luckily for me, it's actually productive. So I get the chance to work on something while, you know, making myself feel great every day.
Yeah, dude. So again, to bring up Andy, my co-host, he's recovering, and he uses golf as his, you know, mental outlet as well. I think we all do in some sense, but, you know, for others, yeah, probably a little bit more than some others. And, you know, we talk a lot about, like, you know, there's competitive golf, right? Like, you know, maybe you're playing your friends for money, or you're playing in some type of event or whatever. You know, there's like golf that you have, you know, when you just go out and you play. And then there's like the golf that's just like therapeutic, right? That, like, everybody dreams of that Sunday morning, like 70 degrees. You're just out for a stroll with maybe like one or two other people. And like, you're not thinking about anything. You're just golfing, you know? And I think for a lot of us, you know, that maybe have memberships at a club, or, you know, and go out play pretty frequently, like, that's their me time, you know? Like, yeah, you might be playing with other people, but like, when I'm out and I'm golfing for 18 holes in 4 hours, like, I am very rarely thinking about work or like life stuff. It's just, you know, out for a nice casual stroll, hitting the ball around, and just like being really in the moment. And I think for a lot of people, like, yeah, golf's an amazing sport, but at the same time, it's also very therapeutic. It can also be addicting, so it can be a little detrimental to some people's mental health, right, with how difficult it is. But, more times than not, it definitely provides that outlet for you to go out and just, you know, kind of have your me time.
I think so. And, I mean, look at a lot of the most powerful people that we see in this world, right? Look at presidents, look at CEOs, look at all of these things. People tend to ask, okay, why is it that these people are always golfing? And I think, to your point, it's one of those things where it's their me time. It's their therapy. It's their whatever it is, because, you know, you don't see these CEOs, these people able to get a huge amount of time away from employees, other vendors, family, all of these things. And then they take their time and they go and golf. I mean, when I was a member at a private club when I was living on the East Coast, the people that were playing 50 rounds a year, and we were only open from like April to October, people that were playing 50 rounds a year all were, you know, these CEOs, because of the fact that they were just trying to do something in their afternoons that gets them out of the office. So I definitely, you know, I'm right there with you in that, you know, there are people that are the let's golf people, and then there's the let's go golfing people. And it's, it's a very different view of how the game is played.
Oh, for sure. And kind of on that topic, like, I mean, you're down in Arizona now, and you've seen over the past couple of years, like, is the sport getting a little too out of hand and too expensive right now? Like, I remember when we came down, gosh, it was probably 3 months ago, and I hit you up, and I was like, hey, man, I think we're playing Greyhawk, but they're charging like $400 to play 18 holes. I'm like, dude, it would be cheaper for me to go and play a guest round at Estancia or something with a caddy and a cart than it would be just to walk Greyhawk.
Right.
What are you guys seeing, one, down in Arizona specifically, because it's blowing up down there with a lot of the Californians coming across, but are we starting to get to a point that like the sports are getting a little too expensive and a little too kind of crazy right now?
I think I think yes and no. So yes, in the way that tee times in general, and I think that this is a nationwide thing, tee times are getting more expensive and they're getting harder to get, especially for our friends in Southern California who are going through, you know, the tee time broker issue and all of these things. That part of golf is getting very inaccessible, very, very hard for a lot of people because, to your point, here in Arizona, so TPC Scottsdale is literally right out there. The fairway of the ninth hole is like right out there. And I don't play golf here in Arizona between October and May because of the fact that the prices are just are ridiculous, right? Like I'm fine with paying $65, $70, $80, $90 for a round of golf. That is fine. But the moment that, you know, the course that I live on becomes $210 for a round of golf when I can play in the summer for $65, or the stadium course, which I know that everybody thinks is all great and wonderful, but the stadium course is what, $600 during the spring?
Yeah.
During the summer, I play it for $99, right? And so I sit there and I go, yes, the weather might be better, but at the same time, I don't see the value in playing golf for that expensive. Now, on the flip side of that, we're looking at quote unquote, I don't like to say it's like non-golf, so I'll say golf adjacent or golf parallel activities. So if you're looking at things like the Top Golfs of the world and like the simulator facilities, right? Like we have a bunch of them around here. There's Zion, there's Ryder Indoor Golf, there's Bushwood Sims, there's just all of these different indoor golf facilities that are on simulators. And then there's the things that are like the, just the driving ranges that have the top tracer, that have the iRange, all of those things. Those things, on the other hand, you know, are seeing a huge boom in popularity because of the fact that everything else is so expensive, and you know, getting a bucket of range balls is still $20, right? And in that bucket of range balls, you can play a virtual course on, you know, on the iRange. You can play it on the top tracer. You can play it on the Trackman range, whatever it is. So I think that on course golf is 100% getting way, way, way too expensive, way too hard to do, way too exclusive. I mean, even here in Arizona, which this is one of my favorite stories, and I love to see people's faces when I tell them this, we have a country club here that's invite only, that's $1 million as an initiation fee.
Scottsdale National, right?
Right. Yes, sir. And, you know, what some people don't know is that you can't just roll up and say, hey, I want to be a member, here's $1 million, cool. Before you even get to do that part, you have to pay for a $30,000 Scottsdale National experience. And if you go on PXG's website, you can find this, where you end up, you're there for 2 days, you stay on property, you get a couple rounds of golf, you get fit for all of your stuff, you get, you know, you get 24-hour turnaround on build of clubs, and you have to meet the owners of the company before then they are the ones that invite you in to be part of their club. That being said, back to your point, you don't get as many rounds as you want. For $1 million, I think that you'd probably deserve a little bit more than that. So it's one of those things where, yes, way out of hand, but at the same time, there are golf adjacent activities that still give you the opportunity to golf, but not for $1 billion.
Yeah, I like to talk about, just, you know, we're a pretty new podcast. We've probably been around for a year and a half now and had a lot of really cool guests on. It's really sweet how like the golf world is actually really small when you start to like get into it, right? Like you're only one or two people away from, you know, probably somebody that has Tiger Woods' number. Probably only one person.
100%.
But like from a, you know,
I would say, I think that a lot of us are probably one person away.
Yeah, exactly. But from like a podcast and, you know, brand creator perspective, I mean, this is not my full-time job, but I love doing it. It is like, it kind of irks me, but at the same time, it's really cool to see like Callaway sponsoring, you know, athletes and podcasters, and TaylorMade doing the same thing, and like really golf in general starting to kind of like what we were talking about a little bit before the podcast, like it's changing a little bit, right? Like it's kind of getting out of that old stigma of like country club, like pants, belts, everything tucked in very neat and tight, to now where you have like the swag golfs of the world and the Malbon golfs of the world who are kind of like changing that. And so, you know, like the stuff that we do, and then starting to get into the fashion aspect of it, like, I don't know. I feel like there's this new era of golf coming with these kids coming up that are hitting the ball 350, that are, you know, maybe wearing a little bit different type of clothes. They're maybe kind of like that Brooks Koepka guy, like a little chip on his shoulder. It's going to be really interesting to see the next 10 years of how golf unfolds, YouTube golf, content creators playing courses, and like people watching golf just, you know, on Instagram now. I mean, it's going to be really interesting to see how it plays out.
The moment that Tiger Woods publicly addresses his son watching people like us on the internet, you know that we've made a decently large wave in the industry, right? And, you know, Tiger Woods literally said it, I think it was either yesterday or 2 days ago, that, you know, Charlie Woods spends a decent amount of time watching golf stuff on, you know, TikTok, on Instagram, whatever it is. So, you know, I think that the industry is changing in a huge way. I mean, even 5 years ago, you would never see a pair of golf shoes, you know, like this, right? You would never see a pair of Jordans that has to say that's a, you know, Jordan Golf on the bottom. That would not be a thing. All you would see is, you know, the casual just black shoe.
Yeah. Or the foot,
because
the
it looks
standard
good with
foot
black
joy.
Pants and black
yeah,
polo.
The standard leather foot joy that,
you know,
everybody
that
knows.
So we're in a place where the game is changing in a huge way. And, you know, I think that, you know, it's great that so many creators are starting to get picked up by all of these companies. But I think that there is a huge space that is being left for more diverse voices to be injected in some of these companies, right? And so, you know, it's wonderful that companies are getting on the boat of working with, you know, people like Roger Steele, people like Doug,
dude, I just met Roger
Lowry,
Steele.
You know, all of these things.
Bro, I met Roger Steele.
Coolest
dude
in the world, isn't he?
That guy is so fucking cool. I was out at Blue Jack National like a month ago, and we were coming off like the 18th hole, and you have to drive by the first hole. And dude, I've seen him so many times, right? And I knew it was him. And I drive up to him like, hey man, are you Roger? He's like, yeah, what's up, bro? And I was like, I've been watching your stuff for like years. He was getting drone footage of Blue Jack, and man, I had to shout out Roger, because that dude's one of the coolest guys I've ever met. He's awesome. I'm gonna try and play with him when he comes here for the three
he really
Abbott,
is.
Month. Yeah,
that's gonna be so much fun. I mean, so he works with Callaway. If I'm not incorrect, he still works with Callaway, and it's one of those things where it's great to see people like that get it, finally getting their due and finally getting to use their platform. You know, use their platform, expand their platform, and, you know, work with those big brands. But as I said, I still think there's a huge opportunity to open those floodgates a little bit more and get more diverse voices in there, especially seeing that, you know, right now, a lot of the golf fashion is falling back on things that come from diverse voices. I mean, you know, you look at Eastside Golf, right? Eastside Golf made their Out of the Mud collection to talk about how, you know, This is the mud that used to cake their shoes as they used to walk to the golf course. And then it used to be green grass, right? Those aren't stories that you're traditionally hearing through the Callaways of the world, through the TaylorMades of the world. And I think that there's just a huge opportunity for that to be done. But, you know, this new generation of golfers is more diverse than ever before. So I have an odd feeling that that's going to end up happening here very, very.
Oh, for sure, man. You're 100% spot on. It'll be, I think, the big turning point that everybody's kind of waiting, you know, that shoe to drop is like, what's going to happen with the, you know, PGA and LIV? How are they going to figure out their differences and create one tour and get like all the best golfers back? It's so like annoying and people don't even want to deal with it and talk about it anymore. But until that gets resolved, you know, it's kind of like the old golf and the new golf. Like once those worlds collide, that's when I think we'll start to see a lot of changes. So I know we got to wrap up because I got to roll to a one, but it sounds like when I come down, I figured out that the way that you go viral, like in the golf world, is you have to make a hole in one on video. So I think when we come down, we're going to, maybe we're going to have to, maybe we'll play champions or somewhere that's a little bit easier. I'll play from like the white tees or something. We'll see if we can dunk one.
Say less. I know someone who lives on the course, and you know, no, this would be a great place to do it. And if TPC doesn't work, then we can always go to Dobson Ranch, which is the mecca of golf creators as it stands right now. So that would be a great place to go because everybody's filmed there, and I'm sure that they would love to have us.
Hell yeah, man. That'd be awesome. I appreciate you coming on and taking some time. We'll have to talk soon. I'll let you know when I'm coming down to Arizona so we can play, man.
Sweet deal. Let's do it. Looking forward to having you.
All right, brother. Appreciate it. Take it easy, man.
Likewise. Talk to you later.